In this video, we're talking fuel trims. And this video is going to be designed to really be an early start in understanding what a fuel trim is, what it does, and what it can tell us so that we can begin to use that in engine performance and other diagnostic work. Before we talk fuel trims, let's talk about the general engine control system. So in a vehicle like this, I've got a mass airflow sensor that is trying to determine the quantity of air that goes into the engine so that we can properly pair the correct amount of fuel with it given the driving conditions and the need, you know, output needs of the engine. And so the mass airflow sensor is very high priority in that. It helps us determine air going in. I meter my fuel by determining how long we're going to put the injector open, right, to determine how much fuel is sprayed into the combustion chamber. And then on the way out, oxygen sensor picks up how did we do, provided that we're in closed loop operation. So in open loop, which is my base calibration and what I see when I have certain faults, or I'm still in cold enrichment phases, right, vehicle has not warmed up, the fueling that goes into the engine is based on this calibration table by the factory that kind of looks like this, often a 12 by 12 or 16 by 16 table that plots engine load, generally grams per second on a mass airflow vehicle, versus RPM. So it gives us this wide range, all these cells to play with so that we can really manipulate the proper amount of fuel provided we're, you know, at 3,000 RPM at light load versus heavy load, wide open throttle. You know, all those different situations get covered. And so that base table is there and generally built quite well. It's there to run the engine as efficiently as it can through all these different operations. The thing that that base calibration table doesn't do very well is modifiers. And manufacturers go to great lengths with various tables. There's dozens of other tables and modifiers that go into an ECM to help with, you know, cold enrichment, to help with, you know, ethanol percentage if it's a flex fuel vehicle. They modify fuel based on engine coolant temperature, intake air temperature, on and on. There's a long list of these variables that help modify that base calibration just in standard process. But we know that over time the engine's going to wear, and mechanically it will be different at 20,000, 50,000, 200,000 miles. And so we need to be able to accommodate that. There's also then some environmental factors with air density and things like that, fuel quality. All those are going to play into ways and places where maybe we can't anticipate it without new information. And so that's what a fuel trim really tries to do. It's trying to take, hey, we did our best. We planned, we engineered, we calibrated. But hey, we went through those phases and it could be better, right? And so that's where we take information from the oxygen sensor because that's on the output side of this process. You know, it took air in, put it through combustion, it came out. And so this is the guy at the door looking at, hey, how did we do? How was your experience, right? And it's looking for oxygen content in the exhaust that serves as an indicator for how well I went through combustion, right? And so we express these into air-fuel ratios, and stoichiometric values are often the target. This tells me how well did I do for that provided instance, right? The wide open throttle or light throttle, and can it be better? So back to this open and closed loop. Closed loop is the operation where I'm taking O2 sensor feedback and I begin to make adjustments. So those adjustments are called fuel trims, and the fuel trims are broken into two categories. We work with a short-term fuel trim. Short-term fuel trims are the real-time adjustment based on sensor data. And so those are the real-time numbers. We'll check in a minute on the scan tool and see that those move very readily. The second one is long-term fuel trims. Long-term fuel trims are an average of what we saw happen and occur in the short term. So we're trying to take those short-term numbers and record them, store them, so that we can make adjustments. And so when all runs well, we see our short term is always a relatively small number because it shrinks back to zero as it pushes long term numbers. The end result is that we've got to look at both short term and long term together to acknowledge what we call a total fuel trim. Total fuel trim is the sum of my short and my long together. And in the end, that's what the fuel injector modification really becomes, is a total of those two things. So to get a look at these fuel trims, we're going to use our 2015 Buick Regal with GDS2. This goes through our MDI2 interface box. And so we're going to go ahead and read the VIN on that, get into diagnostics, So on this particular PID list, just on my screen now, we've got four different pieces of information. I've got my short term, my long term, something they call fuel trim learn, shows it's enabled, means it is active, and then fuel trim memory cell, and that's just the cell in that table where things are being stored or recorded. Basically, where is it hitting right now in operation? But let's focus on short and long term. So short and long term, as I mentioned, work together for total fuel trim. And these numbers can be both positive or negative. And so the way that that works is negative numbers mean that the vehicle has seen a rich condition. It thinks the engine is running too rich. It wants to fix that. And so it aims to take fuel away in order to correct that rich condition. Conversely, on the other side, if I see a high positive number, that's because the engine control module has seen through the oxygen sensor that the engine is lean, and it wants to fix that lean condition. And the fix for my lean condition is to add fuel, and so a positive percentage means we are adding more fuel to the engine. So this particular car right now is showing a good example of a pretty high short-term fuel trim number. So we consider short and long term together to get our total trim. And general guidance is that we want to see our total fuel trim be 10% or less, right? And that can be positive or negative. So our window, that could be negative 10% up to positive 10% total fuel trim. And we could consider that to be rather normal operation. But if we get beyond that 10%, then we're a little bit concerned. And it is natural that short term is going to fluctuate. So we saw almost negative 17, 18% on this particular car, and now it is moved, right? And so we watched just now while I was explaining and see that we went from having a pretty high negative short term fuel trim to now long term fuel trim. You can see that it has moved that down. The total trim has remained pretty much the same, but the goal with this was the real time recognized a different running condition, it began to make modifications, and if that modification stays long enough, it gets pushed into the long-term trim, and the total trim stays relatively the same. So that was a good example of watching my short-term numbers go to somewhat of an extreme, and over time, seeing that short-term number build into and shift to long-term, right? And so as a technician, our focus should always be on not only using both pieces of information, but keeping the big picture of what is my total fuel trim, because that's telling me a story as to what the PCM or the ECM thinks is happening in the engine. And that's a narrative that we really got to focus on, is that when we see this data, when we see fuel trims, that fuel trim data is built with pretty limited information. The ECM is putting a stock in what the O2 sensor has told it, and not just the O2 sensor, but think again, big picture. It's relying on what it saw in terms of a voltage value at a pin on a connector at the ECM. If that wire had a problem, if that sensor had a problem, the connector had a problem, this whole line of variables can interact with affecting that value. And the ECM is putting so much faith in just that one value, it's very easy for things to become skewed. And that's just covering the electrical side of the O2 sensor, let alone look at the mechanical side. If I have an exhaust leak here, that's going to impact, if the exhaust leak is upstream of the O2 sensor, that's going to impact what the O2 sensor thinks. And is it wrong? No, but is there an outside variable that it doesn't know about that's impacting the signal? Yes, right? And that's going to make a big difference in operation. So as a technician, what should I do if I see high positive or high negative fuel trims? Well, they should begin to paint a picture about what's going on. So I've got to think kind of in reverse, like we did. If I see a negative fuel trim that's excessively negative in my total fuel trim, well, that means that the ECM is pulling fuel away. It thinks the engine's in a rich condition. So what do I do as a technician? Well, if I see that, I need to look for things that might create a rich condition or might falsify a rich condition, right? So O2 sensor data can falsify a rich condition. Mass airflow data being skewed, incorrect, or you know, a boot being torn, on and on, right? There's a lot of different things that can paint this picture of what the ECM thinks is a rich condition, right? And sometimes I want to verify what's really going on. Is it really rich? Is it really lean? And so that's where some O2 sensor testing is powerful. I create a lean condition, I create a rich condition, and see, does it have the range? and at sea. Another thing, if I really am hung up on electrical information, I can look at a spark plug and look and see mechanically on that spark plug, is there soot, is there carbon buildup, right? Does that tell me the same story of a rich condition occurring? That's my brief video about fuel trims and their operation, a little bit of testing. And this video is really meant just to be an introduction and be exploratory. Fuel trim testing is something that you can invest an incredible amount of time into. There's just a wealth of videos here on YouTube that you can watch that really go into case studies and go into other things. I plan to do some future videos with experiments and looking at how fuel trim changes with misfires and things of that sort. And at the end of the day, we got to look at this as one additional tool. It's easy for us to look at electrical diagnostics and electrical tools as being this saving grace. But at the end of the day, the electrical testing is just like all the other tools that we've got in our toolbox. Sometimes a wrench works, sometimes a ratchet's better. But some jobs, I got to use both, and I got to use a hammer. And the same thing is true with electrical, where one scope test or one scan tool PID is probably not going to fix the car for me or give me the answer, the solution. But collectively, as a kit brought together, it's going to help me solve the problem. And so that's a great outlook to have, is that I'm going to have to piece together these things just like I do in other areas. And even greater than that, test equipment, scan tools, scopes, this is an evolving space. There are great people doing great work and sharing information. And just like we've seen with, you know, transducer testing for oscilloscopes, that has risen and really grown into being something really powerful and being really accessible. And so learning never stops. If you want to be a great technician, you've got to be at that pursuit, always trying to be better, always trying to be quicker. And I think it's a fun journey. Thanks for watching.